Hello and welcome to We Explain DeFi Chain. My name is Daniel and I'm happy to be your host and teacher today. I'm very happy that Lord Mark is joining the show as well. He will take the part of the student and ask me some hopefully not too tricky questions. Together we will introduce you to different topics around DeFi Chain and explain in detail how certain things work. Even some of the things, the topics become more complex, we try to give you good examples so that you can follow along. If you like the show, then let's go crazy on the like button, like there's no tomorrow. Hit it hard, trust me, it helps the project and it doesn't hurt. I just tried it myself before. Subscribe and click the bell button that you miss no show anymore. So, Mark, part three.
Yeah, how are you today?
How are you?
We managed, perfect. We managed everything. We've got sound today. Nothing can go wrong today. Really excited to be here today.
Okay, then we have part three, leverage of DFI, a new topic together with the loans and the assets. Should we jump into the screen share and then we have a look how it works, right?
Absolutely, let's do this. Let's get rocking here.
Right. I said it before, part three of our We Explain DeFi Chain with the decentralized loans and assets, and we will introduce you to leverage of DFI. What's the background of it? So here I have an overview. We have again different opportunities to leverage our DFI position. So here the basic thing you want to do is you want to go long on DFI. So you are betting that DFI will increase in future. And then you can, for example, go long again on another asset. If you have seen part one, you will remember that you just buy an asset with DUSD generated or minted out of your collateral based on DFI. Now we will introduce different ways to go long, even longer on DFI. So we call it leverage. So here, for example, double long on DFI, or with an intermediate step, short an asset and then go long on DFI. And you can repeat it again, but you will see it will saturate. So it's not an infinite way to increase in leverage of 100x or something like that. So then we should directly jump into the first thing. DFI multiple long. So the investment thesis here is the future price of DFI will be higher than today. And you want to participate on this increase more than linear regarding the price. How can you do it? So the first step is you put your DFI as a collateral into a loan and mint DUSD. So here, putting DFI in, getting DUSD, what you are doing with the DUSD, you go to the DEX and buy more DFI. So now you have additional DFI in your position, also participating on a price increase, which may happen in future. And if you go even longer on the position, you can repeat it again. Yeah, so here I have a smaller picture. You're getting out the new DFI, putting again into a loan, generate DUSD, buying again the DFI, and so on. So what will you do in future? So if the price goes up, in future here I mentioned with Y, then you close the loan by paying the DUSD back. So you have to sell the DFI, putting back the DUSD in the loan, getting back the DFI, and repeat it again if you have more than it one time. So here I just put the formula for a double long position. You have the price increase linear. So this is your basic holding you have put at the first step into the loan. And you will get some additional benefits, rewards here with the second part on your multiple long position. Okay, you have to pay some interest.
Question. So, in theory, if I understand it right, you can do this endlessly, right?
Yes.
But only in theory, right? Because at the end of the day, the loan that I get out is getting smaller, 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 and is going towards zero, right? Yeah. So, okay.
Right. So I will show you later a table of the leverage level regarding the number of loans you're getting out. But you will see here, so the basic holding is a factor of one. The second one is one minus or one divided by the collateralization ratio. So it's smaller than one because here the ratio must be higher than 100%. And this will proceed. It's getting smaller and smaller because the new loan is your new base. With respect to this base, you are getting less out. You're totally right. I have some numbers you will see. It's not very much times you can do it because it's fast going to zero.
Okay, cool. Understand. Fantastic. Thanks.
Okay. So here we have again some remarks. For sure, your all trades and profits are in DUSD. It's like in the previous show, the trading pairs will against the DUSD. You have to look on the pool ratio. So that's the thing you have to look on, if the pool is correctly arbitraged or not. You're always getting back the complete amount of DFI. That's the advantage of this procedure. So you're putting your collateral and you will get it back if you close the loan. And this is also what you mentioned before, not your complete capital is working. You're getting less out. And if you repeat it, it's getting less and less. Have a look now. If you are opening loan after loan after loan, you have multiple liquidation risks. So if the DFE price goes down, your investment thesis is not correct. You have to add collateral to several loans, not only one. So you have a multiple risk and you have to look on several loans. So that's the theory. I also create an example just to show what's the effect. Based on numbers. So we start again with $2.50 for an DFI. With this DFI price, maybe I come new to the ecosystem, I buy 300 DFI. So the value here is $750. I put it into the loan and I will get out 500 DUSD. So that's the absolutely minimum, the smallest collateralization level of 150% and no margin. Yeah? With this, now I have 500 DUSD, I can buy again 200 DFI. Here you see it's less than the first position. And I have these additional 200 DFI now as a holding value is $500. The third step will now, I put it again into a loan, mint some DUSD. Then it will be 333.33 DUSD, or as I use it to buy DFI, it would be 133.33 DFI. So then we are holding, the price is going up. For example, here again, the $4, like in part one or two. And then I have to go the steps backwards, like I entered the system. So if I have three loans opened, I first sell my position of the 133 DFI on the DEX, I will get here 533 DUSD. And I have to pay some interest. So here, for example, if it is after 1 year, 5% is the interest of the smallest loan collateralization. And the profit I make here is 183 DUSD or dollar. Then second step is the second loan. Also selling the 200 DFI, getting 800 DUSD back, closing the loan. The profit here is $275. And the last position was my original holding. Here the profit is $450. So overall, I make a profit of the sum. So if I only have two positions, it would be $725. If I have three positions, it will be $908 roundabout. If I just hold my DFI, so I have no leverage position, the profit will be only the first part. It will be the 450 DUSD, and here you see that I generate more profit without having more capital. I just use the loan to leverage my position.
Sounds risky.
Questions?
Sounds risky.
Sounds risky. Leverage is always risky. The risk is that your loan will fall under the level of the collateralization, which is defined in the loan, and you have to put again more coins to hold it. If it is not possible for you because you have no capital, you will lose your loan. So someone else will buy it back, and then your DFI put into the loan are all lost.
Okay.
More or less.
So I think what you want to tell us, it's a very nice tool to use leverage if you know what you're doing, but be very well aware of the risks that you can lose it all. And you lose it even faster than the normal way if the price drops, because it's like this cascading effect. And it's like a box in a box in a box in a box in a box, right?
Right.
Okay, got it.
And if you're just holding your DFI, you cannot lose it. The price goes down, you know, for example, 50% down. Then you had you lose 50% of your dollar value. Mm. And here the loan will be sold to another person. Yeah, there will be an auction. So they are betting on it. And then you have to look who is willing to pay how much for your loan. And this reduces additionally your position to the price drop. Yeah, you're getting, for example, half of your DFI out, and even the DFI are less worth than the starting point. Right. Really risky, for sure. I will have a look also on the liquidation risk at the end of the presentation, so that you get a better feeling how much coins have you to add to reduce the risk. It's also possible to reduce it, but then the leverage effect will be less.
Okay, good.
Okay, then that was the simple part. Now we increase the difficulty level, and now we put an intermediate step. We are shorting an asset in between. So for example, here you are betting on a higher DFI price. You want to leverage it. You want to participate more than linear. And on the same side, you are betting that an asset will go down. How can you do it? The steps are similar. So you put your DFI coins again into a loan. You are getting back an asset in this case, not DUSD. So you're minting, for example, Tesla token, but I would not short Tesla, just for an example. Then if you have this token, you are selling it on a DEX, getting out the DUSD. And with the DUSD, you can do the second step from the example before. You go again to the DEX and buy the DFI. So here we have this intermediate step two. You are minting an asset, you are selling it, you are getting out the DUSD. With the DUSD, you are buying again the DFI you want to hold and you are betting on. And for sure, you can do it again in the same way. You can repeat step one, two, three to increase the leverage position. Right. Again, putting DFI into a loan, getting out the token, selling the token, getting out DUSD, buying DFI. In future, same procedure, you have to go back in this reverse way you are going in. So you are selling your DFI for price Y in this case. Then you have to buy back the asset token you minted before, W. Is now the value of this token. And then you can close the loan with putting the asset back and the interest. And if needed, you have to repeat the steps I mentioned not here in detail because then the list is very long. But here also as a formula, what is your profit? You have again the price difference of DFI. You have the basic holdings here. This is the factor one. You have your first leverage position, one divided by the collateralization level. Now you make this additional profit if the price really goes down of the asset. You're betting on decreasing prices. So this is the difference between V here. You use the DUSD or you're getting the DUSD from selling the asset, and you are getting back, or you have to buy back with the less amount of DFI. So here, this could be an additional profit, and then you have to subtract the fee or the interest. And you directly see if you are wrong with your thesis and W is bigger than V, so the price goes up. This can reduce your leverage position of the DFI. The remarks are similar or nearly the same. So you can make more profit for sure. This is this part, but you have a higher risk because now you have a second asset, which is hopefully independent from the DFI price. So you are betting on in a second way, and this can make more profit, but you have more risk also to lose your collateral because you're minting different assets and tokens. And if the price goes in the other direction you're betting on, you will have a problem. In the first case, we had this position of DFI as a collateral and DUSD. So DUSD is fixed. Your collateral risk or that the collateral is too low, the risk for liquidation only depends on the DFI price. If it goes too down, you have to put again. Now we have two assets. You have the DFI. If it goes down, you have the same risk. But if the asset goes up, you have an additional risk. This is you're more betting higher risk. So be careful. We can tell you, do it only if you are knowing what you are doing, really high risk.
I see two or three scenarios where this really works well. If you have a very big crystal ball, or you really, really have no problem taking on big risks because you have like kind of two variables that really can highly impact your collateral, right? If it goes both the wrong way, then you're out most likely very quickly.
Yeah. And personal opinion, it's not a position for put and hold and have a look in 2 months. So you have to track it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How it progress. Maybe you have to make your own stop loss. It's not possible here. We have no order box. So that you say, okay, if it goes in this direction, I will close this position with some smaller loss before I'm losing everything.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds for me very theoretical. I mean, theoretically, in that way, I don't see that people are going to do this so much, but it's possible to do it, right? I mean, this is really high skill level already here.
Yeah. High skill level will only a few persons out there doing it. But I think a few will use it, yeah? If they know the right asset, well, where they have maybe some background knowledge, how is the company or what's behind going on, that they know, okay, I'm pretty sure that the asset will slowly go down the next 2, 3, 4 months. For sure, someone could bet on.
Okay, good.
Okay, here again, some numbers to show you what's happening. The same DFI price, same DFI as a collateral. So here the value is $750. Now I say, okay, I'm minting half a Tesla token with this collateralization level. So here the value of Tesla would be $1,000. And now I'm selling this half Tesla token on the DEX, getting out the 500 USD. It's the same amount like before, just this intermediate step of selling. And with this, I can use the DUSD to buy again some DFI for holding as a long position. After your 1 year, the DFI price goes up again to $4 and the Tesla price decreases now to $500, just as an example to show what's the effect. So now we are selling again the 200 DFI on the DEX, getting out the 800 DUSD like before. So here's the same profit of this $300. Now I have to use 250 DUSD plus the interest of 5% to buy back Tesla token. This Tesla token are needed to close the loan. With the current knowledge how the background works, so the value here or the profit more or less $237 from this additional intermediate step, and your basic holding has the same profit like before, $450. So the sum overall would be $987. Again, here we had the leverage. Without leverage, we just have the profit of $450. And if you are not betting on a falling asset price, this intermediate step will be not there. So this is the additional profit of the asset going down in this example. Again, really high risk, more variables, higher liquidation risk because your collateralization ratio depends on two prices. But in this way, it could work for you.
Good example.
Okay.
Get it. Yes. Fantastic.
Get it. So these are the two ways for leveraging your DFI position. Now we have a look on liquidation and leverage level you mentioned before. Now we should have a look on the liquidation risk. It will be more theoretical here, so I introduce some variables and explain how the formula shows you the value. In the second page, I have the table how the liquidation risk really looks like for you as a drop in the liquidation ratio. Okay, but first, have a look on the theory. So if your collateral drops below a defined loan level, for example, 200%, you have to increase it. Otherwise, you will be auctioned. Someone could buy it with some for a lower price, so you are losing money. In general, if you are using two coins, DFI and a stable coin, I just mentioned here USDC, they want to provide also a stable coin as a collateral. You can reduce this risk because the stable coin is non-volatile. So you reduce just the volatility of your collateral. Just have it in mind. You can use it to reduce the risk. So what we have the token value. For example, if I generate DUSD, it would be directly the dollar value. I have a collateral value, so that's the value of the collateral I put into the loan, for example, the combination of DFI or USDC. I have a collateral ratio, so this is the current value of the collateral divided by the token value, and this must be greater always than the collateralization level defined in the loan. For example, I'm putting three times more DFI into a loan than I mint DUSD, then I have a factor of three. If the loan is now 150% as a collateralization level, I have a factor two as a margin for decreasing price in my DFI position before this liquidation process starts. So this must be always fulfilled. And now I could be interested in how much the price can go down in my DFI position before the liquidation start. So if this is always true, we have to say, okay, what's the relative part of my personal collateral ratio, this R? So what fraction is needed that no liquidation starts? Mm-hmm. Or in other words, it's the ratio of the collateralization level of my loan divided by the current collateral ratio. From the example before, I mentioned 300% I put into the loan, and the loan has a collateralization level of 150%. That would be half. So my DFI position can decrease in the price by factor two to 50%, and then the liquidation would start. just reformulated to the drop. So that's one minus what should be remain in future. And this drop is maybe a good figure for you to get a feeling how much can the price go down in DeFi or the collateral, how much volatility is allowed for you before the liquidation start. Okay.
Example.
Now, the example always helps having numbers, not the theory. Again, DeFi price of $2.50. Have 100 DeFi, so the value is here $250 in the decentralized loan. And now I have the collateralization level of 200%. So it's not the easy one like before. It's a little bit more tricky. But here with the 200%, I'm now minting as a token $100 worth. So for constant asset value, in this case, it's a DUSD value, my collateral must always be greater than $200, because the loan says, okay, you need 200%. So in the background, there must be a value of 200%, otherwise you will be liquidated. I put in more, I put in 250%, and now the price can go down by 20%. So if I just have 100% DFI in the background, I minted 100 DUSD, I can hold my position if the DFI price goes goes down just by 20%. If I hit this threshold, the liquidation will start. And with these numbers, you can play now a little bit. Yeah? You can play with the collateralization level you use in the loan, and you can play with the amount you really put into the loan. The more I put in, the higher the drop can be. And this is summarized in the next slide as a table. How you can read this table? So in the first column, you see the different collateralization levels mentioned in the pink paper. So it started by 150% and goes to 1000%. That's just the number you need to hold the loan. And the higher number, the less interest you will pay. That's the only thing you have to look on. Do you want to pay interest high or not? And then you go down.
And the less risky it gets, right? So because more
No. I also thought it at the beginning, and then I talked to Yusin.
Okay.
And no, that's not, because this is the level you have to hold in the background. If you're going under this level, the liquidation starts.
So you have you have to feed additional DFI if it drops to make sure that this collateralization level is always that you hold it, right? Okay, get it.
Right. So here you have a factor 10 as a holding. And if you go down this factor 10, the liquidation starts. So the only thing here you are influencing is the interest. High interest, low interest. So the risk, your own risk of liquidation, you can influence by the real collateral ratio you are putting in. For example, we had before, I have different numbers, so we have to think again. My basic example was here. I'm putting in 3 times more DFI into the collateral than the loan is 150%. So here I can hold the position with a drop of 50%. If I now putting in 15 times more collateral in the loan,
then you're safer. Then you're safer,
right? Yeah. I can withstand a drop of 90%. So this is pretty safe. Yeah, 90% is a hard drop in the crypto market. And so you see, going to the right side, reduce your own risk of liquidation. And you also see the higher the collateralization level in your personal position is, the more you have to put in that you will reach the same risk. Here of this example, 1000% of collateralization level and 1500% of real ratio, you can just withstand a drop of 33%. So back to the leverage again. If you want to leverage, you should use low collateralization levels and real high ratio to reduce your risk. If you are going here down, so high collateralization levels and high collateral ratio, the effect of the level will be more or less zero. You have to walk here in this region. But I show again, I show it in the next slide when we have a look on the leverage level. So this table can be interpreted just as a direct drop of your DFI position if you have 100% DFI as a collateral and you mint a stable coin like the USD. So that's easy from the thinking. It will be harder if you are now minting the Tesla token I mentioned before, because then the real collateral ratio depends on two variables, right? The DFI can go down and the Tesla can go up. And this is also an influence on the real collateral ratio. So you have two moving things. If they're moving in the same way, it's not so critical. If they are moving in the right way, so DFI goes up and token goes down, you're pretty sure. Then you're walking here in this direction and reducing the risk. If the asset goes up and the collateral goes down, you're moving to the left direction and then the risk goes up for you. Okay, the last sentence I just see is not correct. I have corrected on my slides, but Mark had an older version. The USD part in your collateral just reduces the volatility. It's not this linear dependence. It's only valid if you use the example of minting DUSD and holding a collateral of DFI and USDC.
Can you change it straight away? Or are you using a PDF now?
That's a PDF. Yeah. I will change, or we are putting again the information into the wiki, and then it will be corrected.
Okay. So exclamation this... mark, small mistake there because we worked on different versions. Just pay attention to that. In the wiki, the right number's gonna be input there. Okay, cool.
Yeah. So it's only valid if you are minting DUSD, then it's correct. Yeah. So it's not completely wrong. If you are minting the Tesla token, it's not correct because you have this other asset also moving and influencing your collateral ratio. That was the rethinking of my formulation. But what is always correct is that putting a stable coin as collateral will reduce your volatility on the collateral side and reduce the risk of liquidation. That's correct. Good. Then we are nearly at the end. Last step. We started with the leverage. So now we should have a look on how many loans you can create and increase your leverage position. So in the examples before, we have two or three steps. You know, I have here a table with five steps, but we will see that the position is getting smaller and smaller. Again, example with numbers helping for the understanding. $2.50 for DFI, 400 DFI. So our investment is $1,000. We are putting them into the loan, getting out 500 USD. If we use this 200% collateralization level, or better, in this case, it's not a level, it's the real ratio. So if you want to use this 200% of your individual ratio, you have to use a loan smaller than 200%, because otherwise you are directly on the liquidation level, right? So in this case, for example, 150% collateralization loan level. Now we can buy again 200 DFI, here we see it's smaller. And our holdings are now 600 DFI. So it's a factor of 1.5 of the beginning DFI position. So our leverage factor in this case would be 1.5. Now, here again, the collateral ratio of your individual collateral put into the loan, and then the number of loans you're using. And here, this gray area I marked out because the increase or the difference is so low, it makes no sense to open again a loan. So you have to use a very small collateral ratio. Here, for example, 175%. So it's really near to the lowest collateralization level of 150%, but there is some margin. With one more loan, you are at a leverage factor of 1.57. The second loan, increase your leverage level or factor to 1.9, 2.08, 2.19, 2.25. You see here the difference is pretty small. So I stopped at 5 loans. And the practical thing, I think, is to have 1, 2, maybe 3 loans, but then it makes no sense for such a small additional factor.
Such open, a high risk, right?
Such a high risk, because yeah, now we have an additional loan, you have to look on the liquidation risk and so on. And you also see if you are here using higher collateral ratio because you want to reduce your risk, for example, 400%, the factor is pretty small.
Yeah.
It's just 25% more than just holding, but also 25% is a nice additional profit. In this example, you can have a liquidation risk or a price drop of 50% for a 200% collateralization loan. So here in this area, maybe you have a good point between risk and factor, but that's very individual. If you are pretty sure that your DFI position is going up, you can use higher risk. So here in this upper area where you are nearer to the liquidation level, if you want to be sure and you want to track every hour how the DFI price goes down, you are here in this lower regions. Yeah, you are far away from the level you need, but then you're also the factor is very small, so the leverage position has less benefit, less profit for you.
Yeah. Okay. So choose wisely at the end. If you are very sure what you do, or if you have a good feeling where the market is going, you can take more risk, you get higher rewards. But on the other side, it can kill you very quickly if it goes the wrong way. Good. Understood.
Right. Mm. Okay. That's all for today. Pretty hard. Leverage is not
It's not child play, DC. I think that's really something. I think we should really say, guys, be very careful out there.
Right.
This is a kind of dangerous play and really only for advanced. It looks easy to make more money quickly, but in general, leverage is it's a good tool, but not really needed. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's always the same with leverage. Yeah. If you have a look on the exchanges, leverage 10, 100 or something like that, totally crazy, really, really high risk. And also the people are doing it. So be careful here. Personally, I think you can find a way where you say, okay, here it's a good point between risk and additional profits. It's possible. It's manageable. But you have to know what you do, and you should be pretty sure that you are betting in the right direction. It's not buy and hold.
Yeah. It reminds me a lot of gambling, especially if the leverage becomes very high, right? I mean, this is like really, really risky. Yeah. Cool. Very well explained, DC. I think it's pretty clear. I like the table at the end. It gives you a very good feeling that endless taking up loans and loans and loans and loans to get the leverage higher gives you very small, it's very diminishing returns. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to do it like 10, 20 times at the end. Yeah. Cool.
That was one of your first questions, right?
Yeah.
How much can it, or how many times can I do it? It's very limited. And from my personal understanding, it's also the reason why we need this future trading on the DeFi chain with leveraging more. Using mentioned sometimes in the past that they want to provide some future trading with leverage. And then you have this factor 10, 100 with even higher risk for sure. This tool, for I just call it now tool, this putting in a loan and getting out, is not created to leverage really a position. You can use it, but it's not the basic thing why the loans are created for.
Cool.
Okay,
Thank you.
then we are at the end. Thanks for all watching this episode. Questions again, put them in the comments. I will have a look on. We are still collecting things people are not understanding. Maybe we need some additional episodes at the end. And I'm also be aware that this is all theoretical. We have to do some episodes later if everything is live, how we really do it. Yeah, how can I put the collateral into a loan and how does it work? How does it look like? At the moment, it's just the theory, how it works to prepare you to these nice features.
Absolutely. And I think, guys, if you have questions on, I mean, first really have a look at the material that DC put together. I think it's awesome. But if you then still have questions, ask. It's nothing wrong to ask. There are no stupid questions. It shows also where people really struggle understanding. And then we can focus on maybe explaining these things a little bit more in detail. Otherwise, we don't know what we should explain, right? So don't be shy. Just reach out and post it in the comments. Teacher DC is gonna be here to help for sure. Cool.
Okay, then we see you again in the next episode. And yeah, we say goodbye.
Absolutely. Thank you. Have a nice afternoon, evening. Bye-bye.